So welcome to the third lecture on mathematical basics on probability. Now, before I say anything, let me tell you what is the need of discussing probability at all in this particular course on artificial intelligence and machine learning. As I've told you in the morning session as also, that initially this field of artificial intelligence was very much populated from the ideas borrowed from philosophy. Now we have a symbolic AI, as we normally tell. But later on, because of some winters in the field of AI, so one has to incorporate the mathematical concept. So accordingly, the computer science people, they have shake hands with the AI researchers, and accordingly, some mathematical model was developed. Now, one thing is very clear that when you, they have shake hands with the AI researchers, and accordingly, some mathematical model was developed. Now, one thing is very clear that when we talk about any AI system or AI model, we need to interact with the nature. We need to develop some system which can interact with the human being, with the nature. And there are two different issues. Hopefully, I'll be discussing this one in much more detail in later on. Now, one is known as the environment with which the AI system is present, with which the AI system is trying to communicate. And the second one is the agent, agent of AI system. Now, so there are two different issues, two different notions. One is the agent, second one is the environment. Now, if the environment is ideal, if everything is deterministic, that if we know every properties of the environment in a better way, then there is no need of probability. Then everything is very much deterministic. So we should not study anything about the probability under this condition. But as you know that all the activities around the environment is normally guided by some probability, by some chance factor. So as a matter of fact, we need to study about the probability in this particular course on AI and ML. And to be more precise, I can tell you whenever I'll be discussing about the naive bayes classifier in one of the lectures and this Markov decision process in some of the lectures in this particular training series, then we need to take the access or we need to take the help of this probability theory. So I find that it will be better to give a very brief overview of probability in the introductory lecture on mathematical basics. But I know that since all of you are from engineering background and all of you have in your particular course, since you have the engineering mathematics, so hopefully probability has already been there in your curriculum. So eventually, what we'll be discussing is a recapitulation for all of you. Maybe for most of you, it will be a recapitulation. But once again, we need to remind it so that our later discussion can be completed in a better way. Now to start with the probability, I need to talk about the random variables. So variables, you know, so to start with, I have to talk about the random variables. So what are random variables? That means the values identified by those variables are not fixed. As for example, I can consider tossing a fair coin. The result will be a random variable. As you know, that if I toss a fair coin, so there could have been two different results. One is head and the second one is tail, either head or tail. So the outcome of this particular random process, if I consider that tossing is a process, tossing a fair coin is a process, then the output of this particular random process, a particular process is random in nature. So you could have two different outputs, two different outcomes. Either you have heads or you have tails. And if I assume that it's a fair coin, so in that case, the probability of each of them will be 0.5. So probability, understand what is meant by that. It will be like equiprobable. These two are equiprobable. That means this probability is given by, I can give you some generic description. So this denotes the probability. This denotes the probability that the event A is true. This is the probability that the event A is true. So how to find out this probability? This is nothing but the number of times I find A is true upon the total number of observations. Total number of observations. So if I toss a fair coin, suppose I toss a fair coin for say 100 times, and I may find that out of 100 times, I may find that out of 100, head is like say 45 times and tail is for 55 times. So accordingly, the corresponding probabilities are like 45 upon 100, that is 0.45, and for tail, this will be for 55 upon 100, that is 0.55. So if you increase the number from 100 to say 1000, then you'll see that the number is even closer to 0.5. Then for 1000 number of trial runs, you'll see that head will be there for say 470 and tail will be there for 530. So 0.47 and 0.53 like this. And ideally, if you increase the number of trial runs beyond 1000, let it be say 1 lakhs or so, then you'll find that almost it is 50,000 and 50,000. So as we increase the trial run, you'll see that this probability of these two events will be same because we are tossing a fair coin. So the outcomes will be unbiased and it will be same. Similarly, if I throw a dice, so as you know, for dice, there are six different phases, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If I throw a dice, so if I consider that it's an equiprobable kind of thing, so in that case, the probability of each phase is equal to 1/6. Now the event could have been anything. So if I say that the event is like it will rain tomorrow, it can also be an event. A is in logical event, or is a logical expression. Like if I say that it will rain tomorrow at Kolkata. How to find out the probability? So obviously there are different aspects which need to be counted over here, but as a simplistic mean, what I can do is tomorrow is 12th February, so I have to take the corresponding statistics over the last 50 years, and then the total number of observations will be say 50 or even more than that, maybe 100, and I have to check out of the last 100 years whether there is a rain on 12th February or not. And if there is say one such situation, one such occurrence, then accordingly I can find that it will be like 1/100 or 1/50, but the value is pretty less because now we are in spring, so it is not a monsoon season, so obviously the raining probability will be much lower, eventually zero, but might be there is some possibility of 0.01 or 0.005 or so. Anyway, but one thing you must appreciate that if I just consider this expression, PA, that is number of times A is true, divided by the total number of observations, obviously the numerator should be at max, it can be equal to the denominator. That means the numerator cannot exceed the denominator. That is quite obvious. And the minimum value of the numerator should be zero. So accordingly, as you know, there is a limit for the probability. The limit is given by this. It can't be negative. So either it is zero or it is bounded by one. So 0 to 1. So this is a range of probability. For any probability, you would be having this particular limit, irrespective of the event. So if PA is equal to 0, suggests that the event will not happen definitely. If I say that tomorrow in Kolkata the sun will rise in the west, so obviously this event will not happen at all. So in that case the probability will be zero. No matter how many times you observe sun at the morning, you'll see that obviously the value will be zero. And there could have been the other chance, that is one. I'm just considering the extreme condition. The event will happen definitely. Will happen definitely. So these are the two conditions, as you know very well. If I say that tomorrow the sun will set at the west, so obviously, as you understand, sun will always set in the west, so this event will happen definitely, and the corresponding value will be equal to 1. Now if A is the event, we can always assign another event that is not A. Not A means not A, that means inverse of A, that can be regarded by A bar, opposite of A. And the corresponding probability I can assign that P of A bar. And as you can understand, P of A bar, probability of having the event A bar to be true is obviously given by 1 minus P of A. So this is only true when we have defined the event in a binary fashion. That means either head or tail. So if there are two possibilities, either head or tail, either it will rain tomorrow or it will not rain tomorrow, or if the sun rises in the east or sun does not rise in the east. So if this is the condition, yes, no, has not, under this condition only I can write this like P A bar is equal to 1 minus P A. However, if I consider a situation like throwing a dice, so you know that for a dice there are 6 different phases, 1 2 3 4 5 6. So these events, so if I consider that for a dice, as you know, there are 6 different phases, 6 different phases. So if I consider A is nothing but phase, the corresponding value is 1. Let me just erase that part.
Sir, what would be considered as biasing?
Sorry?
What will be considered as biasing?
Okay, I'm giving the answer to it. Phase 1, okay. You have posed the question at a very right time. Suppose I'm having a dice like this, having 6 different faces, 1 2 3 4 5 6, and accordingly you could have 6 different possibilities, either 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6. And if I assume that this particular dice is a perfect one, a perfect dice, so if you throw the dice 6x number of times, x could have been 100 200 500, on an average you can expect that each of the phase will come x number of times. Now someone of you have right now asked the question, what is meant by biasing? Now for this let me refer to some incident from the epic Mahabharata. You know that during that particular game, when Shakuni has thrown the dice. You know that the dice always will give the answer, will give the result according to his will, right? So in that case, I can't say that the output is undeterministic. Rather, the output is always deterministic. So the output is under the control of its master. Now, when the output is under the control of a master, when you can manipulate the output, that means it's a biased one. It is biased to some particular value. Now we know, if we play that particular game, we know that 6 is a very favorable phase, and we always want to have 6. The score 6 is always favorable, right? So always we try that, or we want that the result will be 6. But if I use a fair dice, so in that case, the probability of having 6 is only 1 upon 6. But if you are not fair enough in playing the game, in that case, there is a possibility that the output will be inclined to some particular phase, maybe 6, maybe 5, maybe 4. So when the output is inclined to some particular phase, to some particular outcome, so in that case, I can consider it to be a biased output. And otherwise, if it is fair enough, that means any possibility is possible, then it is known as an unbiased kind of outcomes. So anyway, so since we have 6 different phases over here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so I cannot associate any event like this, because if I say that having 1 as the output is equal to A, then I can't say that having the output 2 is opposite of A. So I can have two different conditions. If I regard A as having 1, then A bar will be like not having 1. So in pretty have this kind of thing. Having one or not having one. I request that if you have any query, you can put this query in the chat box so that I can answer it later on. Otherwise, might be it creates some problem. I'll try to clear your doubts as much as possible. Okay, so having one is one particular event, that is A. And A bar is regarded as not having one. So not having one means you have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 all together. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in that particular case, if I assume a fair dice, so the probability of having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 will be uniform, and that value will be 1 upon 6. So in that case, I can write P of A will be just 1 upon 6. And obviously, P of A bar means what? Not having A. That means all these 3, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And the total probability is 5 by 6. So this is also true. P A bar is equal to 1 minus P A. But this is also obvious that if one of the event is sure to happen, that means if A equal to P of A equal to 1, then P of A bar must be equal to 0 and vice versa. That means if P of A equal to 1, then P of A bar is equal to 0. And if P of A is equal to 0, then P of A bar is equal to 1. Because these two events are mutually exclusive to each other. Now, let us move to the concept of this discrete random variables. Now, discrete random variable, if I consider, it can take on any value from a finite or countably infinite set X. If I consider discrete random variable, so why discrete, you understand? Because this tossing a coin or throwing a dice, so the number that we are getting is discrete in nature. It is finite. So either you have two outcomes like one head or tail, or you have six outcomes like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that's why the value is discrete in nature. Like your numbers in examination, it is discrete. Either the minimum bound is 0 or the maximum bound is 100. So it can have any value between 0 to 100. So discrete random variable. So let me discrete random variable. So let it be X. So this discrete random variable can take on any value from a finite or countably infinite set. So if I consider that X belongs to if x, if I say that x belongs to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up to 10, so it's a finite set. And if I say that x belongs to say z, where z is the, or z plus, z is the set of, z plus is the set of all positive integers, then it's a countably infinite, right? So the probability of the event x equal to x, so this is the random variable, so it can take on any value. Now for the dice example, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 only. Now the probability of the event x equal to x is given by P of capital X equal to small x. And this is called the probability mass function, or in short, it is also given by P of X, P of small x. So capital X is a random variable and small x is the outcome, like either 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 for this dice example. And as you understand, already I have mentioned that this event is, that particular condition must hold good. That means here the value of probability, this px, must be limited within this range 0 to 1, where x can be anything, either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. And if I just sum up all the value of x, that means x belonging to this capital X, this will give us a value of 1. Irrespective of whether the experiment which you have carried out, whether this is a biased one or unbiased one, it will always be true. The total summation must be equal to 1 always. For example, I might be having a biased dice over here. Suppose I'm having a biased dice, which is not a perfect one. Biased dice, which is not a perfect one, for example, for which, suppose I have altogether thrown that particular dice 100 times. And say probability of 1, I mean, having a face equal to 1, suppose the total number of observations is 100, and suppose it is, say, 12 times. Probability of 2, suppose it is like 13 times. Probability of 3, equal to, say, let it be, say, 20 times. And suppose probability of 4 is, say, it is, let it be, say, 15 times. This is an unbiased situation. And in fact, you cannot divide 100 by 6. So suppose this is also 15 by 100. And what is left? The last phase, now if I add, obviously out of 100, 12 plus 13, 25, 25, and we have 20, 45. 45, and we have 30 here, that is 75. So 25 is left, 25 by 100. So these are not uniform. So 0.12, 0.13, 0.2, 0.15, 0.15, and 0.25. These are not uniform. But however, if I follow this one, that x belonging to capital X. So what is capital X here? So capital X is nothing but, capital X is nothing but this set, this particular set, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the individual value is the corresponding sample value, x equal to 1, x equal to 2, x equal to 3, and so on. So it must satisfy these properties that probability should be greater than or equal to 0, but less than or equal to 1, as you understand. And if I just consider the overall, the total number of such events that can be produced by these random variables. So this random variable can produce here 6 number of events for this dice experiment. So the total probability, the summation of all of them must be equal to unity. So sometimes you could have a situation where these probabilities are uniform. Now, for this coin tossing experiment, I can have, say, I can toss a coin 100 times. So there is a coin. Suppose I'm tossing it, say, 100 times. And I may find that head is obtained for 50 times and tail is obtained for another 50 times. So in that case, I can say that these are uniformly distributed, or the distribution is uniform. Even for dice experiment, I can take a whole number. Instead of taking 100, if I take it like, say, let it be say 180. Now for this dice experiment, if I take it say 180, if the total number of observations, if it is like 180, so under this condition, you will find that if they are uniformly distributed, that means if the probability of having a phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4, phase 5, and phase 6 uniform, then under uniform condition, the uniform probability will be uniform probability is equal to total observation is say 180 and they are uniformly distributed, so 30 each, that is equal to 1/6. So you have 6 different phases, 6 different outcomes which are uniformly distributed. So for uniform distribution, the probability will be 1/total number of outcomes. Now for dice experiment, you have 6 different phases, so that's why 1/6. And for this coin tossing experiment, you have 2 different outcomes, so that's why. So this is for dice experiment. This is for dice experiment. And for coin experiment, coin toss, it will be like 1/2, because there are 2 different outcomes, possible outcomes, 2 different possible outcomes. So 1/2 only. Now, let us move to some complicated consideration. Let us consider the probability of a union of two events. Probability of a union of two events. Let me write it down first. Probability of a union of two events. So suppose there are two events. So far we have considered only one event. That means either tossing a fair coin or say throwing a dice like this. Now suppose we have two different events, and these two events might be dependent or might be independent as well. Now given two events, x and y, random events obviously, two events like x and y, these are the two events, now we need to find out the probability of x or y as follows. So the probability of x or y is the symbolic or notation given by p of x plus p of y minus p of x and, so this is the symbolic and notation. So let me represent, this is symbolic or, symbolic or, and this is symbolic and. So these symbols are popularly employed in some of the fundamental AI logic, which involves the predicate logic. This is symbolic and. So there are two events. x and y. And if I want to define the probability of x or y, so this is given by the probability of x in isolation plus probability of y in isolation minus there could have been some joint probability. That means both x and y, they are happening together. So the joint probability is also there. So we have to exclude this one. Now, in case these two events are mutually exclusive, under this condition, if these two events are mutually exclusive, then we cannot find a situation where this x and y, they are happening together. So under this condition, this p of x and y will be zero. And I can write, this will be nothing but px plus py. So if the two events are mutually exclusive, if x and y are mutually exclusive, then it is straight away px plus py. Let me give an example for that. For example, I may consider that x to be the event, or rather I can give two such examples together. X be the event of tossing a fair coin. And suppose y is the second event, say let it be throwing a fair dice. So as I am mentioning a fair, so that means a uniform kind of thing, uniform probability, throwing a fair dice. Now, since it's tossing a fair coin, so I must understand that the uniform probability will be applied. So P of head is equal to P of tail, that is equal to half. And here, P of each phase, so I can write like P of yi is equal to 1 upon 6. Where I can be anything, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now suppose I do these two operations together. Suppose there are two persons. One person will toss a coin and the second person will throw a dice together. Now there could have been any possibility. Either head will be resulted and the dice will be having a result of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or tail will be there as the output of tossing a fair coin, and after throwing the dice, you can have any result. So here, these two events are not mutually exclusive. So they can happen together. You can have any condition, right? So then this P of X and Y will not be zero. Otherwise, later on, I'll give you some example where you'll find that these two events are mutually exclusive, in which case this P of X and Y will be equal to zero. Now let us consider the joint probability. So what do you mean by the joint probability? So first of all, let me write it down, the name on the top of this slide. Joint probability. Now while we say joint probabilities, so there should be more than one event. The probability of the joint event X and Y, the joint event, that means there are two events X and Y, and I would like to find out the joint probability, that means both X and Y together. Obviously, this will not happen. This will be inapplicable for mutually exclusive events, because under this condition, the joint probability will not exist because these two events cannot happen together. So obviously, we are considering a situation where they are not mutually exclusive. So the probability of this joint event X and Y, so I can write Px comma Y, or I can also write this one like this, symbolic notation, x and y. That means both of them are acting together. So that can be written by this. So we have two events, x and y. This is given by P of x given y and P of y. What do you mean by that? The joint probability that x and y are happening together is equal to the probability of having x given y is true multiplied with the probability of y. And sometimes it is also called the product rule. This is also known as the product rule. So given a joint distribution on two events, Px, y, we can define the marginal distribution as follows. So P of x is nothing but the summation of P of x, y, and the summation has to be carried out for all y. In other words, if I expand this one, this will be P of x, that is true, because we would like to find out the probability of x. The condition is that y is equal to yj. And we need to multiply with the probability of y equal to yj. And this is to be done for all y. So we are summing over all the possible states of y. We are summing over all the possible states of y. Similarly, we can also define the py. So let me get this part. This is j, this is not y. I mean, this is not I, this is j. Similarly, we can also define P of y. So P of y is nothing but P of x, y over all x. These are known as the conditional probability, as you know. P of x given y, that means y is true. In that case, we should write like this, P of y given x equal to xi. X equal to xi, for example. And accordingly, you have to find out what is the probability of having xi. And that has to be done for all x. This is known as the sum rule or the rule of total probability. This is the sum rule. Or the rule of total probability. Now, if you observe total probability, from the product rule, we are finding out the occurrence of joint probabilities that both x and y are happening together. From the product rule, that both x and y are happening together, what is the probability? And from this sum rule, we are trying to find out the value of P of x or P of y. That means the probability of having the event x only, or probability of having the event y only. So in doing that, we need to take the help of this conditional probability, this P of x given y. This is known as the conditional probability, this one. P of x given y, conditional probability. What is meant by that? Probability of x when y is true. Probability x given y is true. Now this is multiplied with P of y to have both x and y to come together. Now, x might be true because of z also. X might be true because of z also, but we are not taking into account this one. We would like to find out the probability of both x and y. What is that? probability of x first given y, and then it is to be multiplied with probability of y. And following the same logic, we can also find out what is the probability of the event x in isolation and what is the probability of event y in isolation. Now, these joint probabilities, that particular rule, product rule, can be applied multiple times to yield the chain rule of the probability. And so, for example, if I have, like, say, a d-dimensional vector like this, instead of having x only, if x is like, let me tell you, now, if there is a set of d variables like this, so that can be written in terms of the product rule, like I would like to find out p of x1, p of x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, up to xd. So there are d elements within the vector x itself, like x1, x2, x3, up to xd. And I would like to find out what is the total probability of p of x1 colon d. So that can be easily written by using the notion of product rule, that p of x1 and then p of x2 given x1. If I write like this, what I will be getting? This is nothing but p of x1 and x2 as obtained from the product rule. Then I need to include x3 as well. So that can be written like p of x3 when both x2 and x1, they are true. Now, if I write like this, this will give me the probability of x1, x2, x3 together. Now I need to include x4 as well. So this will be p of x4 with x3, x2, x1 together. So this will give me probability of x1, x2, x3, x4. And if I carry out the same process, ultimately I'll end up with p of xd with x3, x2, sorry, it will start from xd minus 1. So xd minus 1 like this, xd minus 1, xd minus 2, x2, x1. So this is nothing but the extension of the product rule, which we have discussed so far. So the conditional probability, we have already mentioned. So let me categorically mention it over here, or at least write it down, conditional probability. So the conditional probability event A, given the event B is true, conditional probability. So this is like P of X given Y, or A given B. So what is that? This is the conditional probability of event x given the event y is true. So given this is true, what is the probability of event x? So this is sure to happen, event y. So mathematically, that can be written like p of x comma y upon p of y. Because if you multiply this one, p of y with p of x given y, this is nothing but the joint probability. So conditional probability p of x given y is given by p of x comma y upon p of y. Now from this, we could devise what is a very fundamental rules, and I'll be using that particular rule in some of the lectures, and which is the well-known Bayes rule. Now, combining the definition of conditional probability with the product rule and sum rule, we can have the Bayes rule, or also it is known as the Bayes theorem. It will be better if I write it down over here. The Bayes rule, and from that, this naive Bayes classifier has been derived, which is one of the most important classifier classification operation in machine learning. So that's why I would like to mention it once again. So Bayes rule says that the probability of having the event x equal to x given y is equal to y. So this is the conditional probability. So already we have seen that from the expression of conditional probability that this is nothing but p of x equal to x and y equal to y upon p of y equal to y. I think it will be better if I use a different notation. Then you can understand the difference between the random variable and the random process. So let me, for Bayes rule, let me use a different notation. Same thing, but to make you understand a better way. So for Bayes rule, suppose this is the event A, and the outcome is suppose small a, and the event is B, the outcome is small b. So this is nothing but P of A given A and B is equal to B divided by the probability of having B equal to small b. So capital A and capital B, these are the events, and small a and small b, these are the outcomes. So small a is one of the outcomes of the event capital A, small b is one of the outcomes of the event capital B. Now for this coin tossing experiment which we have performed, so A could have been either head or tail. This small a could be either head or tail. Similarly, for this dice throwing experiment, suppose this is the event B throwing a dice. Now the small b can be either 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, or 6. So Bayes rule says that it combines the conditional probability with the product rule and sum rule, and it says that this is nothing but probability of event A equal to A into the probability of event A is equal to A given B is equal to B divided by probability of A is equal to some A dashed I think I've done a mistake over here while writing the conditional probability. It will be reverse, the conditional probability. The probability of B equal to B given A equal to A and here you need to consider all such events A dashed. So this is to be done for all areas. So it's a little bit complicated, I believe, this Bayes rule. Now I think that can be discussed with the aid of some example, then you can understand the Bayes rule in a better way. Now let me tell you the same thing by means of some explanation. Suppose there is a rectangular position like this. So there are number of rectangular boxes in between. Identifying the x coordinates and y coordinates. And suppose I need to pick any particular value of x and y out of that. Suppose this is xi, any particular x, and this is any particular y, yj. Now suppose we consider two random variables over here, x and y. So as you find out over here, for x there could have been five different values, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and for y we have three different values, 1, 2, and 3. So altogether you could have 15 different possibilities. So if you select any particular pixel, either this one or this one or this one, you could select this xy combination arbitrarily. So accordingly, the selection of these values x and y, this ordinates and abscissa, this is random in nature. And to make sense that these are random, let us associate two random variables with it. Let it be x and y. So I can consider that let it be two random variables x and y. And for each x and y, two random variables x and y. Now, assuming that x can take values like xi, x can take values xi, any xi I can consider, where I can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So here I have considered only 5. So in general, I can consider up to m, x can take any values xi. And similarly, y can also take values yj, for example, any yj, where j could have been anything between 1 to l. In this particular case, we find that m is equal to 5 and l is equal to 3. This is the special case here. If I want to represent generically, so this will be the generic expression. Now consider a total of n number of trials in which we sample both of the variables x and y. So total number of trials be n. So n number of trials, obviously n is pretty large, and we are sampling both the variables x and y here. And let nij is the number of such trials for which x equal to xi and y is equal to yj. So this is the number of trials in which we find x equal to xi and y is equal to yj. Then I consider ci be the number of trials in which x takes the value of xi. So this is the number of trials in which x equal to xi. I should make a note over here. Irrespective of of the value of y. And similarly, I can associate another number like rj. So this is nothing but the number of trials in which y takes the value of y equal to yj, irrespective of the value of x. So number of trials in which y equal to yj, irrespective of the value of x. Irrespective of the value of x. So if I represent this is my xi, and if this is yj arbitrarily, then if I select randomly this particular pixel, and how many times I am selecting this particular pixel is given by nij. So let me use the pointer. So this is the xi, for example, this is yj. Now how many times I select this particular pixel is given by nij, the number of trials in which x equal to xi and y equal to yj. And what is ci? The number of trials in which x is equal to xi. So if I select any pixel in this particular column, then the number is ci, the number of times I select the pixel from this particular column is given by ci, and rj is nothing but the number of times I select the elements or I select the pixels from this particular row. So now I can write down the probability that x will take the value of x equal to xi and y will take the value of y is equal to yj. That is the joint probability. So the joint probability, so we have two different events of picking x equal to some value xi and y equal to some value yj. Now if I would like to find out the total probability, the joint probability of having both x equal to xi and y equal to yj, this is known to be the joint probability. So joint probability of having or of selecting, I should write selecting, of selecting, because I am selecting it randomly, of selecting x is equal to xi and y equal to yj. So this is nothing but, so symbolically I can write, this is the description, joint probability, this is equal to xi, so there will be comma, because the joint probability, no conditional probability, joint probability, y is equal to yj. What is that? How many times I have selected this one? Let me go back to the previous slide. How many times I have selected this one? I have selected nij number of times out of n trials. So this is equal to the numerator nij, and the denominator we should have n. Now let us take a look at the individual probability. The probability that x takes the value of xi is irrespective of the value of yi. What is that probability? Probability that x is taking a value equal to xi. So I'm not writing down the meaning for that. Perhaps you can understand what is meant by p is equal to x equal to xi. P of x equal to xi, that means the number of times you are selecting this particular column. So which is nothing but the numerator you should have ci, and the denominator you should have n, because total number of trials is n. Similarly, I can also write p of y equal to yj is equal to rj upon n. Now, while writing this expression, P is equal to P of X equal to XI, so what is that? This is nothing but the probability that X takes the value of X equal to XI, irrespective of the value of Y. So this is equal to the number of instances in column I. It's just the sum of the number of instances in each cell of the column. So P of X equal to XI is nothing but, so you are in this particular, so you are in this particular column. Now, if you select any element, any pixel from this particular column, that means you are selecting X equal to XI. Now, it can be the corresponding value of Y could have been anything. What is the range here? Y can take values, already I mentioned, Y can take values, YJ, and J equal to 1 to L. So you can take any value of Y from 1 to L. So accordingly, you should consider all the joint probabilities. That means P of, let me write it down. Suppose this is 1, or say 1, 2, 3, 4. So P, I think it will be better if I write it down over here, then you can understand better way. Let it be like, this is x1, this is x2, this is x3, x4. So let it be x4 and say let it be y1. Say x4, y2, and x4, y3. Now we would like to find out P of x4, that means x equal to x4. Now that could happen with y1 or y2 or y3. So I could select either x4 y1 or I could select x4 y2 or I could select x4 y3. And remember, these three events, these are mutually exclusive. If I select x4 y1, I'm not going to select x4 y2. If I select x4 y1, I'm not going to select x4 y3, because these three events or these three pixels, they're disjoint. They are mutually exclusive. If I select any particular pixel, so I'm going to, or I'm going not to select the other pixel. So selecting x4 y1 and x4 y2 and x4 y3, so these three events are completely disjoint. They are mutually exclusive events. So if I would like to find out the probability of selecting the elements from this particular column, the column number 4, so accordingly, you need to find out the joint probability of x4 y1, x4 y2, x4 y3, and you need to add them up. Why addition? Because few slides back, we have discussed that if I have two different events like x and y, and if they are mutually exclusive in nature, then the total probability is nothing but the summation, px plus py, because the AND operation will give you 0. So if I follow the same logic over here, I can write that px equal to xi is nothing but, obviously I need to select px equal to xi, that is true. And over here, the y value can be anything. So y can be any value, y can be any yj. And that is to be summed from 1 to L. So here L is equal to 3. So accordingly, you have to find out the value. Now let us define this. So we have defined this joint probability using this particular example. Now let us define the notion of conditional probability using this particular explanation. Now, if I would like to find out, suppose it will be better if I go to the next slide, because the next slide deals with the conditional probability. So the conditional probability for this particular example, P of y is equal to yj given x equal to, sorry, this will be capital X, given x equal to xi is what? Once again, let me go to that particular diagram. This is the conditional probability, that probability of y is equal to yj given x equal to xi. So if I once again go back, what is the given condition? X equal to xi. So I need to take a look at this particular column and take a look over here. Now here I find that out of three possibilities, since I have used L is equal to 3, so out of three possibilities, only over here, I find that y is equal to yj. That means y2 for this case. Apart from that, if I consider this one or if I consider this one, y is not equal to y2, even if x equal to x4. So I need to select that particular pixel. Now already, as far as our notation is concerned, the nij signifies the number of trials when x equal to xi and y equal to yj. That means this one. So now, what will be the numerator? The numerator will be nij, because the total number of observation will be nij, in which x equal to xi and y equal to yj. But since it's a conditional probability, what about the total number of trials? The total number of trials is not equal to n. The total number of trials is ci, because ci is the number of trials in which x equal to xi. So I have restricted the total number of observations over this particular column when x equal to xi. So x equal to xi was the prior condition. So I cannot consider the other values of x. So as a matter of fact, the numerator will be nij, as we have done before. But the denominator, we have ci only. Because ci is the number of times or number of trials in which x equal to xi. And out of that nij number of times, I find that y is equal to yj and x equal to xi, both of them. Now from that, we can derive the relationship, probability of x equal to xi and y is equal to yj. This is the joint probability once again. What is that? You know, the joint probability, that means both of them will occur together, irrespective of any condition, irrespective of any prior condition. So what about the total number of trials? The total number of trials is n. And in the numerator, we should have nij, as we have already derived. Now, this can be written like this. Let it be like nij upon ti and ci with n. Now what is this one? Nij upon ci. This is nothing but p of y equal to yj given x equal to xi. And what about ci upon n? This is nothing but the probability of x equal to xi. Why? Because already you have mentioned this one, px of xi is equal to ci upon n, because the total number of trials equal to n, total number of trials equal to n, and out of that, x equal to xi is true only for ci number of trials. So that particular event, p of x equal to xi, is given by ci upon n. So under this condition, we find that this entire thing is nothing but nij by ci. And this entire thing is nothing but ci by n. So that means the product rule of the probability is also satisfied for this particular explanation, which you have considered for this illustration. Now you can also explain the Bayes theorem using this one. Rather, I think it will be better if I explain the Bayes theorem from an example. So the example says that suppose there are two boxes. There are two boxes, red and blue. So there are two boxes. One red box, and we have another blue box. Now suppose in red box we have, for example, two apples and six oranges. And in the blue box, suppose we have three apples, and suppose I have one orange. Now someone has to pick up any of the box, and accordingly the fruit is selected. Now the question is that what is the probability that the selection procedure will pick an apple? That is the question. Question is that what is the probability? Now you are selecting any of the box, either red box or blue box, and after selecting that box you can select any fruit. The question is, what is the overall probability that the selection procedure will pick an apple? So let me frame the question first. Here is the question. Now this person can select or can pick up any of the box, either red or blue, and suppose there is a corresponding probability associated with that. Suppose we have a probability of 0.7 over here, and we have a probability of 0.3 over here. So probability of selecting the red box, so the probability of red box, P of R is equal to 0.7, and probability of selecting the blue box, P of B, is equal to 0.3. Now you have to find out the probability. So there are two fruits, apple and orange. So P of A and P of O. So you need to find out the probability. What is the overall probability that the selection procedure will pick an apple? What is PA? So you can select the apple from either from red box or from blue box, but what is the overall probability? Now, first of all, you have to understand that if you select the apple from a red box and if you select the apple from the blue box, so these two events are mutually exclusive. So these two events cannot happen together. So being a selector, you can either go for the red box or you can go for the blue box. So these two events are mutually exclusive. Now, first of all, suppose it is given that you have selected this red box. Now, if it is given to you that you have selected red box, now under this condition, what is the probability of selecting apple? So there are eight fruits together, and out of this, there are two apples and six oranges. Then I can write it down like this: probability of selecting an apple given you have selected the red box. Probability of selecting apple given you have selected the red box is how much? two apples out of eight fruits. So once again, if there is no bias, if you select it independently, then out of eight fruits, so there are eight fruits, and it will be two out of eight. So this is 0.25. Similarly, from the second box, from the blue box, you can also select apple. Now suppose it is given that you have selected the blue box, and out of this you have four fruits, three apples and one orange. So obviously here in the denominator you have four, the numerator you have three, that is 0.75. So these are the two conditional probability, that given you have selected the red box, then selecting an apple is equal to 0.25, probability is less, and given the blue box is selected, the probability of selecting this apple is only 0.75. But you don't know whether the selector, suppose this is selector S, you don't know whether the selector has selected this red box or blue box, because this is uncertain with a given probability 0.7 and 0.3. So you need to find out the priori probabilities. P of R is equal to 0.7, P of B is equal to 0.3. Now I can use this Bayes theorem. What is P of A? P of A is given by P of A given E1 into P of E1. There is a box number one, or rather, it will be better if I use that particular notation. Either I can say box one, box two, or I can use the name itself. Plus P of A given B into P of B. What is P of A given R? Red means the first box. It is 0.25 over here, multiplied with P of R, that is 0.7. And then you have 0.75 over here, multiplied with 0.3. And this will give you the final result. The final answer. If you have a calculator, you can find it out what is the answer over here. And this will give you the overall probability that the selection procedure will pick an apple over here. Now, let me move to the another part of this probability, which is all about some statistical measurement. And since we are talking about the random variables, there is a high chance that the corresponding value of this random variable might not be constant. So somehow you have to quantify the value for your application. And to quantify the value, since we do not know what is the value at any particular instant, so this is quantified, this is characterized, in other words, by means of some statistical variables. And let me start with the very fundamental statistical variables, the mean and the variance. The mean is nothing but the expected value of any random variable. Mean or average, sometimes it is also known as average, expected value. Now, mathematically, it is given by this function, expectation function E. So this is E of X for the random variable X. So this is nothing but if I would like to find out the average, so what is done? If I have, say, the average, if I would like to find out the average marks of the students in any examination, then what I should do, I should add up all the marks and I would divide by the number of students. But here, the marks are deterministic in nature. That means we know what are the exact marks. That means I know that for student one, this marks is deterministic. This mark is fixed. For student two, this is the marks. So I can easily find out the average value. But if the values itself, if they are random in nature, then under this condition, instead of performing a simple average, I should perform a weighted average kind of thing. And this weight is nothing but the probability mass function of that particular variable. So that can be written like E of x equal to x of px for all x belonging to capital X. So this is nothing but the average or mean. And for if the variable is a continuous, so for a discrete random variable, we have put the summation sign over here. And if it is continuous in nature, this is true for discrete random variable. Discrete random variable. And for continuous random variable, I can write, instead of having a summation over here, what I can do, I should use an integration sign for all x. It should be like x px dx. This is for continuous random variable. Now, apart from mean, there is another important statistical parameter which we popularly encounter. This is known as variance, which is a measure of the spread of a distribution. So variance is the measure of the spread of the distribution. So this is defined like this. If the variance is less, that means the corresponding random variables, their fluctuation is less. And if the variance is more, then I can say that the fluctuation is more. So variance of X is given by the expectation of X by X minus EX. So EX is nothing but the mean operation, mean value, whole square. This is the expression for variance. And after simplification, you can find that it is given by E of X square minus E of X whole square. In case for a zero mean process, zero mean random process, the variance of X is given by E of X square only. And with the variance, we can also assign another important variables pertaining to the statistical property of a random variable. This is known as the standard deviation. Standard deviation, which is nothing but the root variance. Standard deviation. That is equal to root over of variance. So I should write standard deviation as a function of X. So the variable is X, random variable is X over here. So I should take a note, this is root over of variance of X. So this is the expression for standard deviation. Now, let me very briefly show you, although I don't know whether you have any knowledge regarding this or not. For any continuous random variable, let me show you a particular distribution. one distribution is for lower variance, the second distribution is for higher variance. So this is X. And suppose this is the probability function P of X. Suppose the mean value, so this is a Gaussian distribution. I do not know whether you have this knowledge. So this is a Gaussian distribution of a particular variance. And let me show you another variance. Considering the mean to be same, just like this, even more spread it out. So here, as you can understand, this is having, the second graph is having higher variance. So higher sigma, sigma squared. So variance is normally represented by sigma squared. A standard deviation is represented by sigma. So this is having higher sigma. And this first graph is having a lower sigma. In communication, we are very much fond of this type of distribution of noise signal in particular. Now, let's move to the covariance and correlation. The covariance between two random variables, x and y, it measures the degree to which this x and y, they are related. So, covariance of two random variables, covariance of, so whenever you talk about covariance, so obviously it will involve two random variables. So it measures the degree to which these two random variables x and y, they are related. So mathematically, it can be written like covariance x comma y. This is nothing but e of x minus ex. And y minus ey. So this is equal to e of xy minus ex into ey. So that can be shown. Covariance is given by e of xy minus ex times ey. Now, if you make any attempt to find out the covariance between two random variables, then there is a high possibility that this value is becoming very large. In fact, the minimum value of covariance could be zero, and the maximum value could have been as high as infinity. So sometimes it will be much more convenient to work with a normalized measure, so with a finite upper bound. So to make sense, to limit the covariance value within a certain range, within a certain upper bound, the correlation coefficient has been introduced. And this correlation coefficient between two variables is given by correlation between x and y is equal to covariance of x and y root over variance of x into variance of y. So in this way, it is bounded. So in order to characterize any of the random variables, mostly so I am once again referring to the communication environment. So we will be dealing with some random noises more often. So under this condition, we cannot identify what is the value of the signal at any particular time, because you will see that because of the noise present within the environment, the corresponding value of the signal is getting modified. And even that this is true for our present discussion on AI and ML, you'll see that, as I was mentioning, the environment with which we will be dealing with, this is not a static environment. The environment is not at all deterministic. So accordingly, the actions which we take, this action is not at all the deterministic action. Depending upon the response that we receive from the environment, the action taken by the agent is also stochastic in nature. So while considering this stochastic property or probabilistic property of any environment, we need to deal with the random variables. And that's why in this particular lecture, I have tried to make a very basic description, although this particular thing might be well known to you from your knowledge in mathematics, engineering mathematics. And even the computer science people or the information technology people, they know it much more better, because they have more classes on probability and statistics. They need to deal with that. But still, for the sake of completeness, I have to discuss this one as a part of our discussion. And with this, let me conclude this particular discussion on probability theory.